Okay. We'll start with the prayers all together.
सरस्वती नमस्तुभ्यं वरदे कामिनी
विद्यावहे शांति
वासुदेवेन्द्रयुक्तं ॐ नमः शिवाय सो लास्ट टाइम वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट तत्व विवेकः वी हैड जस्ट स्टार्टेड द सेकेंड चैप्टर ऑफ तत्व बोध वेयर द स्टूडेंट आस्क्स द क्वेश्चन व्हाट इज तत्व विवेकः एंड द टीचर रिप्लाइज बाय सेइंग आत्मा सत्यम तद अन्यत् सर्व सर्वम मिथ्या मीन्स ओनली आत्मा सत्यम एंड एवरीथिंग एल्स इज मिथ्या एंड देन वी डिस्कस्ड द मीनिंग ऑफ द वर्ड सत्यम एंड मिथ्या So we said satyam is a independent existence and mithya is dependent or borrowed existence. So we used the example of the pot and the clay. So we saw it in four steps. First step, there is something called pot. Second step, there is something called pot and there is also something called clay. The clay of the pot is also there. Then the third step, we said that actually clay is a higher reality and pot depends on this clay for existence. And in the final step, we said that actually there is no such thing called pot at all. All that is there is clay alone. Okay, so this is the satyam mithya relationship. So if I ask you, what is the relationship between pot and clay? So interestingly, up to the third step, you can say pot is mithya, clay is satyam, because pot depends on clay to exist. But in the final analysis, you will say there is no relationship between pot and clay because there is no such thing called pot at all. Okay, that is the ultimate analysis. Up to the third step, you can say that mithya borrows existence from satyam. Okay. So this is the understanding. Now remember very clearly that mithya means dependent existence and satyam means independent existence. Okay, many times we may have heard the word mithya previously and in other books and all you will find meaning of the word mithya as unreal and which gives the meaning that it is not there. But it is not there. The pot is very much there, right? It is just that the pot borrows existence from clay. That should be the understanding. Dependent existence. So write this into your mind, this definition. It is very important. Mithya means dependently existent. Now, just to go a little more deeper into this topic, I have taken one verse from Bhagavad Gita. Second chapter, 16th verse. So those who are attending the Gita class, you have already covered this. And here we will just see briefly, okay, very briefly. So the verse goes like this. Na sato vidyate bhavaha, na bhavo vidyate sataha, ubhayor api drashtontaha, tvanayos tattva darshibihi. Now the important line for us is the first line. It says nasato vidyate bhavah na bhavo vidyate satah. So we can divide it into two pieces. This is the first part and this is the second part. The meaning of the first line, the first half, is that there is no existence for asat. There is no existence for asat. Here in this verse, the word asat means mithya. Okay, we have to take it to mean mithya. So there is no existence for mithya. And the second part is na bhavo vidyate satah. There is never non-existence for sat. I will repeat that. There is never non-existence for sat. Note that it is a double negative. Never non-existence. So what happens? They cancel each other, which means sat exists all the time. There is never non-existence for sat means sat is there all the time. This is the meaning of the two things. So what they are talking about here is actually the same concept of satyam and mithya. Okay, so when here the word asat is used, it means mithya, and here the word sat, which is of course satyam. So here we're going to look a little more into this, and we're going to discuss it in terms of this thing that I've written here at the bottom, swabhavika dharma and agantuka dharma, the intrinsic nature of an object and the incidental nature of an object. So what this means is that every object has an intrinsic nature. It is the swarupa, the natural nature, swabhava of that object. For example, fire is hot. The heat of the fire is a swabhavika dharma for fire. Heat is swabhavika for fire. Why? Because it is natural and it is always there. Can you ever separate fire and heat? Can you put them apart and tell this is heat and this is fire? No. Where there is fire, definitely there will be heat. Right? They are almost as good as being the same thing. In fact, all heat arises from some kind of fire, if you see in the whole world. So that is why it is swabhavika. Fire and heat, they kind of go always together. Now, what about water? Is water hot all the time? No, right? You have to supply heat. If you want hot water, you have to supply the heat. You have to give it from outside. If you put a pot of water to boil, it is going to borrow from the flames, from the stove, and then it is going to become hot. Suppose you put it away from the fire. What happens? The water again cools down and goes back to its normal temperature, right? So for water, heat is a property that comes and goes. So do you see, in fire, there is always heat. You cannot separate it also. Wherever there is fire, there is going to be heat. But in water, if you want it to be hot, you have to supply the heat. And the moment you separate it from the fire, that heat also goes away. So for water, heat is a property that comes and goes. Comes and goes. And that is what is called as agantuka. Agantuka means coming and going. And in English, we call it incidental nature, or a borrowed nature. So for water, the heat is a borrowed attribute. It is not naturally hot. It borrows the heat. So this is the relationship. So this example you understand clearly. Fire is always hot. For water, heat comes and goes. It has to borrow from fire. Now, how is this relevant to our asat and sat discussion happening in this verse? So what the verse is telling is that there is something called sat. That sat is also called atma, brahman, all the different words we use. So that sat vastu, the object of sat, that has existence as a swabhavika dharma. as an intrinsic nature. It has existence itself as a swabhavika dharma, which means it is always existent. It is always there. There is never a time when it is not there. You cannot say it is born on this day, it will end on this day, and in between we don't know. It is not like that. There is never a time when it is not there, which means it was never born and it will never die. So the literal meaning of the word eternity, okay, eternity, immortal, limitless, boundless. So never a place where it is not there, never a time where it is not there, because it is always there everywhere. And that is why it is Sat. This Vastu is Sat. And that is why for this Vastu, this existence is a Swabhavika Dharma. Okay, existence is Swabhavika Dharma for this Atma, this Sat. Now, what about this world, the Jagat that we see around us, the universe we see, including our own bodies, by the way? Is the body there permanently? No, right?
No.
We know body is not there permanently. It comes and goes. Different bodies come and go. What about planet Earth? Is it there permanently? Was it there before? No. And there's going to come a day when even Earth, the sun, the solar system, this is also not going to be there. Which means what? That they have permanent existence or temporary existence?
Temporary.
Right? Very obviously, all of these objects in the world, they have temporary existence, not permanent existence. In fact, even the universe itself has temporary existence. How do we know this? Because scientists now tell us that something called Big Bang happened, and that is when you can say the universe was created, so to speak. And then there is, they also predict that there is going to be a day long into the future when the opposite of Big Bang happens, a kind of involution happens, and the universe will go out of existence again. So this whole universe is also temporary. It also comes and goes, which means for this universe, existence is a Swabhavika Dharma or is it Agantuka Dharma?
Agantuka
Dharma, because it is coming and going out of existence, right? Agantuka literally means coming and going, temporary. And for this universe, existence itself is coming and going, which has to make it an Agantuka Dharma. Which means what? The universe is borrowing existence from somewhere, from something that already has Swabhavika Dharma, as existence as Swabhavika Dharma, right? Like the water and the heat. Can water simply become hot? No. Water has to borrow heat from the fire. When they are close by, it will naturally borrow heat from the fire. For the universe, for this world, it borrows existence from this Atma, from this Sat. Okay? And that is why this universe is Mithya. Everything that you see around you is Mithya. Mithya means dependently existent, borrowed existence. And what is the object that is lending the existence, so to speak? It is Atma. Atma is Sat, which is Satyam. And universe is Mithya. It is borrowing the existence. That is why Shankaracharya has famously said, Brahma Satyam Jagan Mithya. Right? So that is the meaning of this verse, that there is never existence for Mithya and there is never non-existence for Sat. Because Sat has existence as Swabhavika Dharma. Sat is always there, everywhere, all the time. Whereas for this Asat, for this Mithya, it never really has any existence. Because like the pot and the clay, in the fourth and final step, what did we say? There is no such thing called pot at all. Okay? So that is why, that is the relationship between Satyam and Mithya. So it's okay if you did not understand this topic. This is a bit higher level and it will come again in Bhagavad Gita in much greater detail. Okay, now we will move on from this Satyam and Mithya topic. Before that, do you have any questions?
Omitaji?
Yeah.
Why in Svabhavika Dharma and Agantuka Dharma, what's the connotation of the word Dharma?
Dharma means attribute or property.
Okay. And yeah. In other context, Dharma also means like...
Yes, in different contexts, it means different things. Here we have to take the meaning as attribute or property.
Okay.
So an incidental property or incidental nature, an intrinsic property, intrinsic attribute, intrinsic nature, that is the meaning you have to take. In other places, other contexts, you may have to take the meaning of dharma as right actions, those kind of things. It changes. It's a contextual meaning always.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Megha ji, it's like a body. Shareer jaise is mithya. It's made of five elements. Is it something like that?
What is made of five?
Yeah, our shareer, it's a mithya. It just made of five elements. When it get burned, it just merge into five elements. Is it what you are explaining right now? Ki shareer itself is a mithya.
Yes, Shareer is mithya because, okay, finally it merges back into five elements. But those five elements are also mithya.
Medhaji, this Sat is an object or an attribute only?
Sat is, it is Brahman, Atma.
But Atma cannot be an object because there won't be any observer to object, observe the object. Right?
There is no better word. Can you give me a better word than vastu, than object?
Yeah, I don't know. That's why I'm asking. I don't know.
It is a limited, words are limited. We cannot, there is no word that you can use to satisfactorily describe Brahman. Every word is limited. Every word will definitely have a limitation. So, they do use different words. They use tat. Tat means that. Okay, that is one way of referring to Brahman. Another is Brahman, Atma, Sat.
I think Vastu. Brahman is words.
Brahman is one word.
You may call it entity or something.
Entity, anything, whatever, any word you use, finally, if you're referring to that, it's going to be anyway a limited word and a limited... there's no other way. There's no better way.
Thank you.
Yes. So what exactly is Atma? Now we will understand. So the question that you were asking about the body is mithya, so it merges into five elements. But those five elements are also mithya. They will also merge back into something else. And something else, and something else, and so on.
Okay. Medhaji.
So, yeah, one minute.
Medhaji, so, the problem is...
Yeah, one minute, I'll finish this. So, yeah, that is why is now we are going to...
Okay, sure.
Yeah, so now we are going to see first what is Atma, and then you will have a clearer understanding. So, the next question that the student asks is going to be, what is Atma? So then you will understand. So one thing to remember when it comes to Atma and Mithya topic, everything you see, literally everything that you can see, it is Mithya, including your own body, including your mind also, okay? Including the world that you see. And including even to some extent, all the gods that we see with form. All the gods with form that we talk about, also mithya. Okay? All right. Now, please tell me.
Yeah, the problem is whatever is mithya, that is visible. We can feel, we can realize.
Yes.
It is easy to understand. But whatever is satya, it's neither visible nor it has any form. It is very difficult to apprehend that. It's only psychologically you accept.
Yes, that is
but
correct.
But like mithya, we can very well see, observe, touch, everything we can do. And we have much better appreciation.
Yes.
But for Atma, for Brahma, it is more of a taking the things, accepting the things as Vedas tell us or as the...
Yes, that's right.
We Atma, cannot really...
Yes, you cannot experience Atma. You can only understand that I am Atma. You can only claim Atma as me, but you can never experience Atma. By experience, I mean see.
Basically, just accept. Nothing. By just accepting it.
Yes.
By
Atma
just
can
accepting
never be
it.
Experienced. That is correct. Only whatever you experience, if by chance you are experiencing it, definitely it is mithya. Okay?
So it is very confusing that the satya cannot be experienced. Mithya can be experienced.
Yes.
No, what about the state of enlightenment? State of enlightenment, when the blissful state is experienced as the streaming of the bliss from everywhere as I am Brahman, that is also mithya then?
Mithya.
So even that blissful state is also mithya?
Yes.
I know, but then Atma quality is that the state of blissful state of moksha.
The moment you experience it, that is mithya. Why? Because to experience it, you need the body. Mithya. If you don't have a body, how will you experience?
Mithya.
This is, the, as you go on, you will
so it's
see
a very paradoxical
the interconnection.
That's what we experience.
The relationship between Satyam and Mithya is very a tricky one because Satyam, if it is there independently, you will never know it. You will never, it's not possible to know about it at all. To know about it, you need Mithya.
It's only, so only you have to just accept it. Basically, you just accept.
You have to assimilate.
Or
yes.
Veda says, Shastra says, you accept it. Otherwise, there is no way to experience it.
So, there's a question in the chat box. What is the relevance of Satya? The relevance of Satya is that it is existence itself. We have all borrowed existence. The reason we exist is because we have borrowed existence from Satya. This is the very substratum of creation, the very adhishtanam. Creation...
This is a very controversial and paradoxical that satya you cannot see, satya
yes.
you cannot experience, and still believe there is a satya.
It is paradoxical, but over time it starts making sense. You will see the truth of
this
it
is like,
slowly, slowly.
This is like, psychologically we keep on brainwashing people, then finally that guy, when he's totally brainwashed, he accepts. So it is coming to something like that.
You know, that is correct, except that it is reverse. We are not conditioning you to believe that there is something called Satyam. We are deconditioning you from all the other wrong notions. And finally, what will remain is only this.
So what will remain, we don't know.
After all the deconditioning, all till now it is all conditioning in a wrong direction. Now if you do all the deconditioning, all that remains will be this alone. So it is not brainwashing.
Sorry to get in this, but then so far we have been completely dependent on Mithya and we know what we have received. So let's try to decondition, maybe we'll get to Satya.
Yes.
I'm using this brainwashing because I'm from the defense background. So the words they use is like that.
Yes,
but the,
it is the opposite.
The essence is that whatever is satya, we cannot experience.
Yes. This you have to understand so, very firmly.
So we have to only accept.
Yes. Okay. So now we will move on.
Thank you.
Yes. We will move on now. To the next topic, the next line. So I think we can read this.
Medha ji, can I ask a question before we move?
Yeah.
So if Satya is something that we only have to accept, how do we know that this is only Satya?
What is only Satya?
I mean, whatever. Basically, we are saying what we see, what we experience is all Mithya. Then how do we know what is Satya?
That is why you need Shastra to tell you. Because okay. Your sense organs will not tell you. Cannot reveal to you what is Atma. The sense organs, there's no object in the world that can, there's no sense organ, there's no, you know, nothing in the world that can reveal to you what is Atma except the Shastra. And that is why, as we have discussed, we accept Shastra as Pramanam. Just like the way that only your eyes can reveal color. Is there any other object for you that can reveal color?
No.
And so for color, you accept eyes as Pramanam. And so for Atma Jnanam, you accept Shastra as Pramanam with the same amount of faith that you have on your eyes. In fact, more. But that takes, that is, I know it is not as straightforward as it sounds.
But then for everything which is the truth, I...
Sorry, I couldn't hear you.
The sound is a little disturbed.
Lata, your voice is not coming through. Lata, we can't hear you.
Can't hear.
You can Hari ask Om. The question later on the group. Okay.
Hari Om, Medha ji.
Yes.
We can call it mystery of life.
With what is the mystery?
Mystery of life that we cannot see Atma. That is the mystery of life.
And what? It's just another word. I mean, it's. Okay, if you want to call it that, but it doesn't help much.
I would say essence of life.
We accept there is Atma. We accept that Atma is Satya.
Yes. But yes, you have to know that is better, what those words mean. And that is important. Otherwise, they will remain just words.
Yeah.
Yeah, but other side, we say our shastras are based on tark. Here we say we have to accept.
No. Tarka, logic, is for support. Logic can never be used to prove the validity of the Vedas. Vedas cannot be proved by logic, nor can they be disproved by logic. That is very important to understand. You cannot use logic to prove, nor can you use it to disprove. But you can... To some extent, up to a point, you can use logic to support. You can use logic to support the statements of Shastra up to one point. And then there are statements that will come that are beyond logic, that where logic does not reach them to either prove or disprove. So those statements we have to accept. Okay, we'll start this topic now, this Atma Kaha. Okay, so we can read this. The question now the student is going to ask is, what is this Atma? So previous sentence said, Atma Satyam Tadanyat Sarvam Mithya Mithya Iti.
You are all students are asking same question.
Yes, all the students are also asking the same question. So what is Atma? In fact, last week, was it Ayush who asked this question, who am I? Who am I? Now, the Tattva Bodha student is also asking the same question. And you're going to see it's not going to be an answer that you can just answer in one line or even in one class. The whole point of this study is to answer this one question. Okay, so now we will see what the author has said. Sthula sukshma karana sharirad.
Sthula sukshma karana sharirad.
Vyatiriktaha.
Vyatiriktaha.
Panchakoshatitasan.
Panchakoshatitasan.
Avasthatraya sakshi.
Avasthatraya sakshi.
Sachidananda swarupaha.
Sachidananda swarupaha.
Sanyastishtati sa atma. So, the million-dollar question, what is Atma, asked by the student. Now, before we start this answer, looking at the verse, I want you to remember that the word Atma, the most literal meaning of the word Atma means me, I, myself. Okay, that is one of the most literal meaning of the word Atma. Why we should remember this is because usually when we talk about Atma, we think, oh, it is some soul, something else, somewhere else, some other object. But no, it is you. That is what the word Atma means, me, I. In English, the word Atma is translated as self, right? And they put self with a capital S. And usually we separate from this thing. When they say self, it means me, myself, I, right? But usually when they put capital S, what happens? It becomes some other object, some third party thing. And now we are describing that other thing. But you have to remember that we are not talking about some different object somewhere else. What I am talking about is you. The answer to the question, who am I? So even though here the question is Atma Kaha, what is Atma? You can take the statement to be, who am I? So what is Atma and who am I are equivalent statements. Okay, so now the answer is going to come for this question given by the author. He says, Sthula Sukshma Karana Sharirad. Okay, this is a big word. Sthula Sukshma Karana Sharira. There are four words here. And you have to connect this word Sharira with each of these. So Sthula Sharira, Sukshma Sharira, and Karana Sharira. There are three things being talked about here. Sthula, Sukshma, Karana, Sharira. The three bodies. Three types of bodies. In Sanskrit, we call it Sharira Trayam. Three bodies. So here the author is telling that these three bodies, which are sthula, sukshma, karana, shariram, these three bodies, this atma is vyatiriktaha. It is different from these three bodies. Okay, so what are these three bodies? We will see in detail in the next line. But for now, just remember that atma is different from these three bodies. Atma is different from sharira trayam. Then he says, Panchakosha Atitaha. Panchakosha is the five koshas, the five sheets, the five layers of a human being. This Atma is Atitaha, beyond even these five layers. So Atma is beyond Panchakosha. What is Panchakosha? That also in detail we will see later. Then the author says, Avasthatraya Sakshi. Avasthatraya are the three states of experience. So the three states of experience are the waking state, the dream state, and the deep sleep state. So those are the three main states of existence, of experience that we have, right? We are either awake, or we go to sleep and we dream, or we go into a very deep sleep where there is no dream. Three possible states of experience, right? And this Atma is the Sakshi, the witness or the observer of these three states. So it is not these three states also. It is the one who observes these three states. And what is the nature of this Atma? Satchidananda Swarupaha. Swarupaha means its own nature, its own intrinsic nature. And what is the nature? Sat, Chit, and Ananda. Sat, Chit, and Ananda. So Sat is translated as existence. Chit is translated as consciousness. Ananda is translated as infinite, infinitely there. So the word Ananda comes from the word Ananta, which you have to take to be limitless, limitlessly there. So many people translate the word Ananda as bliss. It is correct, but you have to understand why we are calling it bliss. The bliss comes out of the limitlessness. Okay, so when there is limitlessness, when there is no boundary, all that is there is bliss or happiness, Ananda. So the Ananda is born out of Ananta, out of infinite. Okay, so this is the nature of Atma. Now this Satchit Ananda also we are going to see in very great detail in the next few classes. So I'm not going to explain too much over here. Then Yat Tishtati, the one who exists this way. In what way? Different from three bodies, beyond the five koshas, as the observer of the three states, and with the Swabhava or the intrinsic nature of Satchit Ananda, the one who has or who exists in this way or who is present in this way, that is Atma. And who is that Atma? You. Okay? So Atma is not, remember, Atma is never some third party thing. It's never something other than. It is always me, I. Okay. Now, if you see this sentence, you will see that the author has not directly started explaining what is Atma. When the question is asked, who am I or what is Atma, he doesn't start by giving straight away the answer. What does he do? First, he does an elimination process. If you see the first three, four words are simply elimination. He first tells not this, not that thing also, not the other thing also. First, he eliminates all those things, which means those things are different from Atma, right? They are Anatma. Anatma is the opposite of Atma. So therefore, Anatma is Satyam or Mithya? Mithya. Anatma has to be Mithya. Why? Because only Atma is Satyam. Everything else is Mithya. So definitely Anatma is also Mithya. So all these objects that he is describing, all these things, the Shariratraya, Panchakosha, Avasthatraya, all those things are Anatma, they are Mithya. And he starts by first telling Atma is not this, this, this. And it's a very interesting way to start. And there's a reason why we start first with the negation rather than first just explaining what is Atma. Okay, so why is because that there is a problem. All of us, we don't know who am I, right? We don't know who am I, but the problem is not that simple. The problem exists at two levels. The first level is called Ajnanam. I don't know who I am. The second level is Adhyasa, superimposition. I think I am something else. Because I don't know who I am, now I think I am something else. So the problem is ignorance plus error, a wrong understanding. Okay. So if you remember some time back, I had given you the example of Tarzan. Remember Tarzan, the jungle the jungle man or the jungle guy, something. So anyway, Tarzan, as a small boy, he's a human baby, but as a small baby, he is, you know, in the forest, and his parents have died. And what happens? A group of gorillas adopt him, and he grows up with the gorillas. And now he thinks he is also a gorilla. He's actually a human being, but because he's with the gorillas, he thinks he is a gorilla. He behaves like the gorillas. There is a problem here at two levels for Tarzan. First, he doesn't know that he's a human being. Second, he thinks he is a gorilla. There is ignorance and there is error. So in Vedanta, we use the famous example of Rajju Sarpa, the rope and the snake, right? Very famous, you know, analogy. I'm sure all of you have heard it. So what is the example? Suppose you're walking on a path and there is something on the road. Okay, and it is little dark. It's not fully dark, but it is not daytime. It is in the evening. And you see something on the road. And it is long and thin and in a curvy shape. And what happens? You think it is a snake. And what happens when you see a snake? Panic, right? You get scared, you are frightened, you're thinking, should I run away? What if the snake bites me? You know, all of those panic thoughts, a lot of emotion, heart beats faster, breath comes faster, adrenaline rush, right? So many things happen. Why? Because you thought you saw a snake. But on closer inspection, suppose you go closer and see, is it really a snake? No, it is just a rope. So where did the snake come from? You superimposed the snake on top of a simple rope. So this rope is Satyam, but your superimposed snake is Mithya. So the snake, the Mithya snake, has borrowed the Satyatvam of the rope and presented itself to you, and you get frightened. This is the understanding. Now, it is very interesting if we analyze. You know, the example appears very simple, but when you analyze, it is actually quite deep. Okay. So when does this confusion happen, this rope and snake confusion? When there is partial light. Suppose there was total darkness. You would not have seen rope also. You would not have seen snake also. You would have just walked on, no problem. Suppose there is total light. Then you would have very clearly seen the rope. And again, no problem. But in the partial light, in the dim light, you saw something. And you thought it was a snake. So what has happened? There is ignorance. And there is error. I see something there, but I don't know what it is. So I think it is a snake. There is ignorance of what exactly that object is, and there is error thinking that this is a snake. Ignorance plus error. Now for all of us as humans, the same problem exists. Ignorance plus error. I don't know who I am, but I now think I am this. I now think I'm the body. I think I'm a girl. I think I'm an Indian. I think I'm the CEO of a company. I think I'm a doctor. I think I'm a mother. I think I'm a daughter. I think I am, you know, rich. I think I am poor. All these things that we think about ourselves, they are error. Why? Because I don't know who I am. So when you have to address this kind of a problem, first you have to tell all the things that you are not. Why? Because the attachment to those things is so strong. If you directly introduce a new thing and you tell you are this, there will not be acceptance. So first you have to loosen the attachment there. You have to decondition. So till now, I believe that I am body, mind, sense, complex. I believe that I am this body, I am this mind, I am these thoughts, I am these emotions, right? And I very strongly believe this. So if you just tell me you are Atma, it's not going to work. First, you have to tell you are not these things. You are not the body. You are not the mind. You are not these things. You have to analyze also why you are not those things. And then that attachment loosens. The attachment to the identity of body, mind, sense complex loosens. And then you can shift that identity to Atma. And then you can claim, I am Atma. Usually what happens? The other way happens. You know, when somebody tells you, you are Atma or you are this, the human mind is such that it takes that this limited body, this limited mind is Atma. Instead of dissolving the limited body mind in the understanding and claiming the Atma, we reduce Atma itself to body mind this much and say that Atma is this now. So that should not be done. Okay. So this is one of the big problems. Just a minute. This is the understanding. So usually, you know, when people make statements like at moksha, you will become immortal. Most people take it to mean my body is going to live forever. Why? Because the identification with the body has still not gone. What the statement means is that you as Atma will live forever. But since you are not the body, body may go. Who cares? But because you are not body, right? But the attachment to body is so strong that when the promise of immortality is given in moksha, we think body becomes immortal and lives forever. That has to be, that understanding has to be addressed. And that is why we have something called sampradaya, the systematic unfolding of the teaching. You cannot directly introduce Atma and tell you are Atma. First, you have to do a whole process of negation. You have to educate the seeker that you are not this, 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 this. Till now you were thinking you are all this, but you are actually not this, this, this. And then the real question comes, okay, if I'm not all this, then who am I? And that question has value because now you are an empty cup. Can you fill a full cup? No, right? If the cup is full of water, can you pour more water into that cup? No, it will not work. It will simply overflow. So if the cup is empty, then you can fill. So first, what we are doing is emptying the cup. Right now, we are doing the process of emptying the cup. So that is why we are going to start by discussing anatma. We're going to start by discussing all these different bodies, all these different things. And finally claim that all of this is anatma, all of this is not you, and therefore drop it. Now you should be asking the real question, who am I? Now the cup is empty, and when this question comes, and when the answer comes, it will work. Okay, so that is the understanding. So I'll just show you this little chart. So here, now we have classified anatma into this these three categories. Sharira Trayam, there are three. Pancha Kosha, there are five. And Avastha Trayam, again three. So altogether, 11 different things are there. And Atma is different from all these 11. Atma is not any of these 11. And in the next class, we will see all these 11 in detail. Now we'll stop for questions.
Megha ji, can you just tell me the meaning of Ya Tishtati Sa Atma?
Ya Tishtati Sa Atma means the one who is present in this way. Ya Tishtati. In this way, the one who is there, Sa Atma. That is Atma.
So, Shivani ji, Om, Nirvana Shatkam, which is the Atma Shatkam. That is also, then that means a similar thing that the whole shloka is about, no? I'm not this, I'm not that. And it's emptying my cup, right?
Yes.
Wonderful. I've understood this today. Thank you.
Nirvana Shatakam, though, is a Nididhyasanam. We use it as a Nididhyasanam text to deepen the understanding. So finally, what is the last line, the chorus line that comes? Shivoham, Shivoham.
Shivoham.
Right? Yeah. So that Shiva has to be taken as Atma, not the Saguna Shiva.
Oh, yes. Venkaji?
Yes.
You used the word, for ignorance, the word is Agyan. So for error, you used the word. What was that?
Adhyasa, superimposition. Adhyasa.
Okay, thank you.
Om Maidhaji, this was a very nice words you used about sampradaya, systematic unfolding of the teaching.
Yes.
So it's a very well expressed, and we can do mananam on this itself, how our unfolding of the teaching helps us understand.
Yeah. Sampradaya is very important to have proper understanding. Otherwise, what happens, a lot of people attend pravachans where the topics are random every day. You know, one day they talk about karma, one day they talk about moksha, one day they talk about something else. And it is very difficult to piece all that together in the mind. Yes. And that is why SPG says that a systematic long-term study is required under a competent acharya. So all the ingredients are required.
Thank you. So we have managed systematic, we've managed competent teacher. The rest is on us.
Long term. Yes, long term is very much on you. Yes. Competent teacher depends on the grace of Ishwara. And systematic, of course.
We are blessed with you, Meghati. Thank you.
It is all Ishwara's grace.
Hari Om, Medaji.
Yes.
When you were traveling on pilgrimage, you sent a photo of that. There is no difference between Shiva and soul, within bracket Jiva.
Yes.
Yeah. So this Shivoham is?
That Shiva you have to take to mean Atma.
Atma. Yes. Shiva is Atma.
So many times when, we hear the word Shiva or Krishna or all these names, we immediately associate them with the form, right? You imagine Shiva with the Trishul and the blue throat and the snake and all those things, lives in Kailash and all those things. But that is just for Saguna. That is just for initial understanding. In the final understanding, that Shiva also is nothing but Atma. When you take the meaning of all of these gods and Bhagwans and everybody as Atma, a lot of these statements will start to make sense. That's why in Vishnu Sahasranama, they say Vishnu is Shiva and Shiva is Vishnu, right? Even in all the many of the places they come. And you might get the question, how can Vishnu be Shiva, Shiva be Vishnu? This is how. They are both Atma.
Right, right. Thank you.
Om Medaji. Yeah. So, as you said, ki Atma is also a Shiva. I said, we have to drop that God is something other than Atma. God is within us, right?
God is within you or you are within God?
Yeah, God is within us or?
Yes, more mananam is needed. Statements like soul is within me and all will go away as you do more and more mananam.
More confusion.
Okay, so we'll stop for today and we'll continue next class. We'll end with Purnamada. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Shanti 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 Hari Om Hari Om Namaha
Guru Bhyo Namaha Hari Om
Om Tat Sat,
Om Tat Sat, Om Namah Shivaya.
Thank you, Medaji.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.